I've attended this breakfast, going all the way back to when it was held at Waters Caterers, for those of you who remember that far back. Never really imagining that one day I would be selected to be the keynote speaker. I think the words of Frederick Douglass will best reflect how I feel at this particular moment in his famous speech, The Meaning of July 4th for the Negro. Douglass said, "He who could address this audience without a quailing sensation has stronger nerves than I have. I do not remember to ever have appeared before an assembly more shrinkingly, nor with the greater distrust than I do of my ability on this day. I know that apologies of this sort are generally considered flat and unmeaning, and I pray, however, that mine will not be so considered. Should I seem at ease, my appearance would much misrepresent me." Again, this is truly an honor, and I pray that my remarks today are found to be of some value. We are here today to celebrate the birth, the commitment, the legacy of one of the greatest American martyrs ever, the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., who was born January 15, 1929. Yesterday, he would have been 88 years old. In the years since his assassination, I have been incredibly troubled by what I consider to be the co-opting of Dr. King's message, his essence, and his persona. What has troubled me over the years is how Dr. King, the visionary, the prophet, the revolutionary, how his message, his actions, and his ultimate sacrifice have been hijacked, compromised, and relegated to being those of just a dreamer. People are comfortable with dreamers. Why? Dreamers are safe. To be a dreamer, you must be in a restful state. Usually, you're asleep. Dreamers are docile. Dreamers are easy to manipulate, and they are also incredibly non-threatening. To cast Dr. King in the light of a dreamer allows people to be convinced that substantive change resulting from clear vision and direct action is not necessary. It allows the oppressed to be fooled into thinking that just being patient and being non-revolutionary, that somehow theirs will come by and by. As Brother Malcolm said, you wind up getting hoodwinked, bamboozled, led astray, you run amok. Just be patient. Our quest for equality in America cannot disturb the fragile sensibilities of white America, for we'll all understand it better by and by. We are often destitute of the things that life demands, want of food and want of shelter, thirsty hills and barren lands. We are trusting in the Lord, and according to God's word, we will all come to understand it by and by. We have been convinced that to wait until the saints are gathered home will tell the story how we overcome. Our story, our truth, our reality must be told today, right here, right now. The theme of today's celebration is charging forward, changing the world. As we look to this Friday, January 20th, and the inauguration of our 45th president, we gather here today to commemorate and celebrate the birth of Dr. King. Charging forward, changing the world made me think about one of Dr. King's most seminal works, Where Do We Go From Here? Chaos or Community. In this work, as Vincent Harding writes in the introduction, King insisted on constantly raising and reflecting on one of the basic questions he posed in the first chapter of the book, Where Are We? And in the overall title itself, Where Do We Go? Now, on November 14, 1966, Dr. King gave a speech at an SCLC staff retreat in Frogmore, which wound up being the outline for the book, Where Do We Go From Here? In the Frogmore speech, he said, "I guess what I want to say tonight will be divided into three parts. First, from whence have we come? Secondly, where are we? And thirdly, where do we go from here?" So this will be my outline this morning. If it worked for Dr. King, it'll work for me. So that our charge forward as we go forth to change the world is not reckless and without direction, we must first understand from whence we've come. In the historical context of our ancestors, enslaved Africans arriving on the shores of North America, the historical record tells us that the first 20 and some odd Africans disembarked from a Dutch man of war in August of 1619 in Port Comfort, Virginia, not too far from where? Mm-hmm. Not Howard. The colonists, being the good Christians that they were struggling with issues such as status of children got by Englishmen upon a Negro woman, or what about the casual killing of slaves? So per the laws of Virginia, Act 12, 1662, quote, "Be it therefore enacted, all children born in this country shall be held, bond or free, only according to the condition of the mother," end quote. So you know what that meant. Okay, Junior, back to the slave quarters for you. Act 1, 1669, quote, "Be it enacted, if any slave resist his master and by the extremity of the correction shall chance to die, that his death shall not be accompanied felony, but the master be acquitted from molestation, since it cannot be presumed, the prepense malice should induce any man to destroy his own estate." Simply put, a slave master cannot have formed the mens rea, the intention or knowledge of wrongdoing that constitutes part of crime, because no one in their right mind would terrorize or destroy their own stuff. This is where we became codified in law as things, chattel, personal possessions, items of property other than real estate. This is our ground zero in America. This is from whence we have come. Du Bois said, "Many people have suffered, but none of them were real estate." Amiri Baraka said, "Oh, slavery in America isn't even really about just getting your butt beat. It's about them transforming you into a thing, which they can dispatch any way they want to. No matter what you do, even today, that thingness is still maintained." This is our history. A history that we should embrace and a history that we should celebrate. Please allow me to deviate for a moment. I want to tell y'all a quick story. Just a minute. The Phoenix Riot of 1898. This was a week before the more famous Wilmington riot. A group of African Americans were going to vote in Greenwood, South Carolina. A fight breaks out, and a white gentleman by the name of J.I. Etheridge winds up being shot. So they went throughout the county, they rounded up all the usual suspects, and they wound up lynching about six people. And I want to say about 15 or 20 folks were overall injured. One of the men lynched was a guy by the name of Wade Hampton McKinney. And with the death of Wade, his family saved and scraped and maybe even stole, and raised enough money to put his half-brother, Ephraim DeVore, on a train, and they sent him north to Howard University. He arrived at Howard On August 25th, 1901, he was 21 years old. He was born on the DeVore plantation in Greenwood, South Carolina, and he had never even gone to high school. So while at Howard, he went to the normal school, he went undergrad, grad, and he left Howard in 1911 with his doctorate in dental surgery. He moved from Howard down to New Orleans, where he became the first licensed African-American dentist in Louisiana. And he practiced dentistry there for about 60 years. Now, while he was practicing dentistry, he would go out into the fields of Mississippi. He would take his oldest daughter in tow, and he would go out into the fields of Mississippi under the pretext of giving free dental care to sharecroppers. And while he had his hands in their mouth, he would whisper in their ear, "You know, if you come off of this plantation, if you come off of this property, and you come to New Orleans, I will help you get a job." Most people in New Orleans called him Doc. I called him Granddaddy. Ephraim DeVore was my maternal grandfather, and that little girl that he took in tow with him was my mother. And to this day, I carry my grandfather's transcripts from Howard with me. Whenever I think that I'm having a challenging time, I look at these transcripts and I get a much greater appreciation of what struggle is really all about. Now, I tell you this story not because I think it makes me special, because it doesn't. I tell you this story because we have a tendency to look at this history as though it's ancient. My maternal grandfather was born on a plantation. I am two generations removed from the plantation. We are a resilient, proud, a resourceful people with a wonderful history. Now back to my remarks. I submit to you that our struggle in this country has never been about civil rights. Our struggle in this country has never been about human rights. Our struggle in this country has always been as formerly, as descendants of formerly enslaved Africans, has always been and continues to be to have our humanity recognized. Our struggle has simply been to be accepted as human beings. Current evidence of this thameness: Patrick Dorsman, Amadou Diallo, Eric Garner, Trayvon Martin, Tanisha Graham, Yvette Smith. We know the names, we know the stories. If you're a janitor, if you're the county executive, if you're a judge, if you're a millionaire, if you're an African American in this country and you get pulled over by the police, you are then in fear for your very existence. Dr. Francis Cress Welsing described a system consisting of patterns of perception, logic, symbol formation, thought, speech, action, and emotional response. Systemic racism, white supremacy. The reason that police officers or even crazy citizens like Dylan Roof and George Zimmerman can formulate the thought to murder unarmed African Americans is because we are still perceived as things first, humans if we're lucky. I'm not saying that in the case of police shootings that the police officers shoot people intentionally because of the color of their skin. That's not my point. But the history and the context in which these events occur force me to ask, if the perceived perpetrators had been white, would the police officers who shot them have felt so threatened? Would the police officers' patterns of perception, logic, and symbol formation, would it have been different with a white suspect versus a Hispanic or African American? Would that difference in perception have resulted in a different emotional response? Would that different emotional response resulted in those individuals being given just one more moment of consideration? And within that one more moment of consideration, would the outcome have been different, most likely resulting in their lives being spared? America has never reconciled what Dr. King and others called the Great Contradiction. Dr. King wrote in Where Do We Go From Here, "The majority of white Americans consider themselves sincerely committed to justice for the Negro. They believe that American society is essentially hospitable to fair play and steady growth towards a middle class utopia embodying racial harmony." What did President Obama talk about on the campaign trail this past season? The middle class, the middle class, the middle class. Even Hillary ran on the middle class. Senate Minority Leader Chuck Schumer talked about being able not only to get people into the middle class, but to keep them there once they get there last week in his first speech as Senate Minority Leader. Dr. King said that this middle class discussion is a fantasy of self-deception and comfortable vanity. Overwhelmingly, America is still struggling with irresolution and contradictions. What are these contradictions? They are the contradictions that were baked right into the very founding documents of this country. The Three-Fifths Compromise, the Fugitive Slave Provision, and the fact that the importation of slaves was allowed to exist for 20 years after the Constitution was ratified up until 1808. So that's from whence we've come. Stripping our ancestors of their humanity, relegating them to the position of property, and codifying it into the founding documents of this country. Now, many of you all might raise your hand and say, "Hey, Dr. Leon, but those provisions, they have been removed from the Constitution. They are no longer the laws of the land." To which I would say to you, especially if you all were in one of my classes, you are absolutely right. But that does not mean that those very concepts and ideas have not become the ideology and formed the mores and the values from which America continues to this day to operate. Dr. King wrote that with the removal of these statutes and the passages of the Voting Rights Act and the Housing Rights Act, there has still been a struggle to treat the Negro with a degree of decency, not equality. White America was ready to demand that the Negro should be spared the lash of brutality and coarse degradation, but it never had been truly committed to helping him out of poverty, exploitation, and all forms of discrimination. That's not Dr. King the dreamer. That's Dr. King the realist. He was, as you so eloquently said, straight up woke. He went on to say, as the nation passes from opposing extremist behavior and more pervasive elements of equality, white America reaffirms its bonds to the status quo. It had contemplated comfortably hugging the shoreline, but now the winds of change are blowing it out to sea. That's Dr. King, the prophet, taking us from 1967 to right now where we are in 2017 with the pending inauguration of Donald Trump. So where are we now? Very simply put, in a period of what Dr. King called a period of white backlash. Dr. Ronald Walters called it the politics of resentment. Dr. King wrote in 1967, "In several southern states, men long regarded as political clowns had become governors or narrowly missed election, their magic achieved with a witch's brew of bigotry, prejudice, half-truths, and whole lies." Sound familiar? Sound very reminiscently, recently familiar? A witch's brew of bigotry, prejudice, half-truths, and whole lies. Again, folks, this is Dr. King. We have fought on that one. That's Dr. King, the realist. Again, straight up bold. On Friday, January 20th, America will inaugurate a narcissistic misogynist who marketed to white backlash by playing down to racist sentiments, bigotry, and hatred. Just as he stole the line, Make America Great Again, from Ronald Reagan's 1980 campaign, Trump also stole the fundamental page from Reagan's racist playbook, as Reagan launched his campaign where? Philadelphia, Mississippi. Trump fanned the flames of xenophobia, ill-founded fears of terrorism. His tweets and illogical rants were and continue to be a witch's brew of bigotry, a whole lot of ignorance, prejudice, half-truths, and whole lies. I only know one way to do this. It's imperative that we clearly understand this white backlash, as Dr. King called it in the politics of resentment. It's not new. First, what is this backlash in response to? What is this resentment directed towards? Very simply put, the election of Barack Obama as the first African-American president of the United States. As Dr. Ronald Walters wrote in White Nationalism, Black Interests, within American society, which includes contending social groups, there exists a balance of power that conforms to the society's racial composition. This balance must conform to the normal distribution of power if society is to remain in equilibrium. President Obama, in the minds of a lot of people, became an indicator that the normal distribution of power is askew and is very much in jeopardy. According to Pew Research, 67% of non-college whites backed Donald Trump, compared with just 28% who supported Hillary Clinton. Hence, Trump's statement, "I love the uneducated." Trump won whites with a college degree 49% to 45%. Per the CBS exit poll data, found that 54% of white women voted for Trump. Trump also won among white non-college women 62% to 34%, and college-educated men 54% to 39%. Now this begs the question, for as nauseating as Hillary Clinton was to a lot of people, how could white women vote for a shallow misogynist who called women pigs and said about Kari Fiorina, "Look at that face. Would anyone vote for that?" Can you imagine that face as the president of the United States? And we know about his reference to women's genitalia and how he objectifies his own daughter. In spite of this, a lot of white women saw value and redeeming qualities in this guy. Secondly, as I just said, white backlash was, as Dr. King called it, the politics of resentment. It's not new, and let me give you some historical examples. Because one of the big mistakes that we tend to make when we do this analysis is we tend to operate as though things happen in a vacuum. But there is a very long historical record. And a lot of places that I can start, but let's start with the Dred Scott case of 1857. Dred Scott, born into slavery in Virginia in 1795, sued for his freedom and won. His owners appealed. The case was overturned. Scott then goes to the Supreme Court and loses in a 7-2 decision, and Chief Roger Taney, issues his infamous decision where he says, in part, a Negro whose ancestors were imported into America and sold as slaves, whether enslaved or free, could not be an American citizen and therefore had no standing to sue in federal court. Negroes are considered an inferior class of beings. There's that thingness again. Who had been subjugated by the dominant race and has no rights and privileges that whites are bound to respect. December 6, 1865, the 13th Amendment abolished slavery, but the backlash was written right into the very amendment itself. Neither slavery nor involuntary servitude, except as punishment for a crime where the party shall have been duly convicted, shall exist in the United States. So, where did that lead us? Took us right into what Douglas Blackman called in his book, Slavery by Another Name, the Reenslavement of Black Americans from Civil War to World War II, into what became known as the convict leasing system. Blackman found that in the South, the timing and the scale of surges in arrests of African Americans appeared more in tune to the rise and fall of the needs of labor, as opposed to any correlation to increases in crime. The Tilden-Hayes Compromise. That's what ended Reconstruction in this country. You all remember the Red Summer of 1919? This refers to the summer and early autumn of 1919, which was marked by hundreds of deaths and casualties across the United States as a result of race riots that occurred in more than three dozen cities. Whites were attacking African Americans. You had the Tulsa riots of 1921. What contributed to this backlash of the Red Summer and to the Tulsa riots? Basically, you had African Americans returning from World War I with money, training, and a new sense of self, and they were demanding equality. And this resulted in making, in a compressed labor market, a lot of people incredibly uncomfortable. You've got the Brown decision in 1954. The backlash to that, because in Virginia, they did not want to integrate their schools, they shut down the public school system. And even when the courts held that they had to integrate, Prince Edward County, Virginia, abolished the public school system simply because they did not want to educate African American children. And they started what came to be known as private schools for white children. It's imperative that we clearly understand that this white backlash, as Dr. King called it, or the politics of resentment, again, didn't happen in a vacuum. So with all that said, how do we move forward? Where do we go from here? As we charge forward, how do we change the world? Honestly, I don't know. I wish I did. I don't have any idea on how to solve this age-old American conflict and the inconsistency. Because what I see on the horizon truly, truly scares me. America has taken a giant step backwards. I really thought that it had learned, that if this country had learned nothing else from Reaganomics, that it had learned, as Samuel Yett wrote in his brilliant book, The Choice, when humanistic services are withdrawn from black people, more whites suffer than blacks. When blacks and masses are denied food stamps, educational assistance, when Social Security, Medicaid, and Medicare are threatened, when unemployment steadily increases, the majority of the nation suffers. Obviously, with the outcome of the election, America did not learn what I thought it had learned. Again, in The Choice, Samuel Yett quotes the late Karl Rowland. We see this outcome because the people today are so preoccupied with their fears, frustrations, and prejudices that they seem ready to abdicate a solemn responsibility to protect our constitutional safeguards. Trump played, and the media allowed him to play, down to white American fears, frustrations, and prejudices. Again, I don't know what to do. I know that my grandparents were fighters. History tells me that we are a hopeful people, a prayerful people, a resilient people. We know what to do because we have done this before. This game is not new. We have seen this movie. We have even starred in this movie. First, we must realize that our salvation does not lie in our government as currently constituted or even its traditional alliances. As Dr. King said, quote, the white segregationist and the ordinary white citizen has more in common with each other than they have with the Negro. Why? Because, as Samuel Yep wrote, Black Americans are considered by our oppressors to be obsolete people. Black Americans have outlived their usefulness. The raison d'etre, if anyone want to correct my French, please do. Was that good? No? Help me out. Thank you. Like he said. Has ceased to be a compelling issue. Once an economic asset, they are now considered an economic drag. The wood is all hewn, the water all drawn, the cotton all picked, and the rails reach from coast to coast. The ditches all dug, the dishes are all put away, and only a few shoes remain to be shined. Or as I would simply say, we're gonna have to save ourselves. We must circle the wagons because, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, the cavalry is not coming. We're on our own. First, we have to start reading. We have to dedicate ourselves to educating ourselves. We have to get a firm grasp on the issues surrounding us domestically and internationally, and we have to understand them within a much broader historical context. We have to understand, as Dr. King, Malcolm, William Patterson, what they did is that the solution of our domestic struggle lies within an international context. Why do you read scripture? Why read such old historic texts? One reason is that from the historical text, we gain insight, guidance, and direction to how to address our current circumstances that impact our lives. And Reverend Robinson is nodding affirmatively, so I guess I'm right. Here's just one example, and I'm wrapping up. Here's just one example. Trump's economic plan is basically cut taxes for the businesses and the wealthy, and the economic power that is supposedly unleashed from all that is going to trickle down to the rest of us. Well, that's what we called in the 80s Reaganomics, supply side economics. George Bush even called it voodoo economics. As Samuel Yep wrote in 1982, it's the new scheme to steal America. Now, much of the danger that was once secret and illegal is now either publicly acceptable and legal, or legally hidden from the public, like Trump's taxes. Understanding those issues, we can fully engage politically. As informed citizens and as an informed community, we can participate in the process from a position of informed individuals instead of one of wishful thinking and of hope. We can hold officials accountable and reward them when they meet their commitments and punish them severely when they don't. Finally, and this is very important, too many of us in the African-American community have lost the understanding that we have only made progress in this country when the focus of our struggle has been on the collective instead of the individual. Du Bois wrote, the souls of black folk, not the soul of some guy. Mrs. Hamer risked her life for the right to vote for all of us, the franchise for all of us. She wasn't just trying to get her place in the ballot box, in the polling booth. Some of you will say, well, wait, you're a political scientist and you've talked for over 20 minutes and you haven't told us what to do. Oh, but I have. Because the answers are in the analysis. The focus of our struggle has always been based upon the success of the collective, not the individual. I will leave you with Dr. King. It is time for the Negro middle class to rise up from its stool of indifference, to retreat from its flight into unreality, and to bring its full resources in heart, its mind, and its checkbook to the aid of the less fortunate brother and sister. Where do we go from here? Chaos or community? It's for us to decide. Thank you.
Jeffrey Slavin and Council Member Tom Hucker are here as well. Thank you.